Hi there, and welcome to Seismic Radio and BPN Radio. And we've got another talk here on the Book of Romans. And it's like I've said before, I'm going to say it again. I've said it many times. The Book of Romans is really, really interesting. It's the foundation of theology, of Christian theology, as the church had its origin after Pentecost or in Pentecost. And started to take off the ground. So we've got the Book of Acts, and we can see in the Book of Acts the development of the church and how the gospel was spreading throughout the Roman Empire and beyond. Not in Acts, but obviously we know historically that later on it went well beyond the Roman Empire. I'm sure within the days of Acts it was taking place. I've been in Pakistan to a place where the Apostle Thomas is renowned to have preached. In India, there are communities which claim that they trace their beginnings back to the Apostle Thomas. And obviously that would have happened in the same period as Paul was preaching. But we have got some amazing stuff when we look at the Bible, when we look at the New Testament. And again, when we look at the Book of Romans or the letter to the Romans, we have got a man who understood the gospel, who understood the theology, and he is writing to a church he doesn't know. So he isn't really concerned about any problems or any issues the church have, but he's just putting down basic theology for the church. And from that perspective, we should treasure the letter to the Romans as giving us an understanding of how to deal with the Old Testament, how to deal with the New Testament, what is the New Testament, what is the core message of the New Testament, to put the gospels into perspective, and to have an understanding on how to build up our faith and how to walk with God. So it's very, very important, I think. I think Luther, I think it was the Book of Romans which made Martin Luther. I have to think about it. I should prepare maybe a little bit more, but I was reading Luther's conversion experience many, many years ago, and I think it was a verse from the Book of Romans, that by faith he is justified, not by works. Not by works at all, and this was obviously what the Catholic Church was saying at the time. You need to work hard, you need to do lots of things to earn heaven, but heaven has already been given and provided through the forgiveness of sins, through what Jesus Christ did, and there's nothing we can take away from it, there's nothing we can add to it. Okay, let's have a look through chapter 11 in the Book of Romans. And it's, again, the last two chapters we were looking at the whole scenario. We've got the New Testament, we've got the Gentiles, and we've got the Jews and the Old Testament. How does it fit together? Where are the Jews? And where's the Jewish perspective? The chosen people by God. God has chosen them. He has displayed himself. He's displayed his great power amongst the Jews. He has given them the law. He has given them a covenant. Now we've got a new covenant, and how are we, tallying it all up? How do we put it all together? One thing which sort of seemed to crystallize very early in Christianity is that the Gentiles were lapping up the gospel right, left, and center, but the Jews were rather resisting towards the gospel. I find it quite interesting as well. We had the nation of Israel, and we find that there are sort of generations. And when we look at in the Bible, sort of a generation is about 40 years. It was 40 years in the desert, and God had a generation, so all men 20 years or older. They were rebelling, and they were grumbling against God when he delivered them out of Egypt. And he said, right, okay, you guys are not going to see the promised land. You will die in the desert. And so they stayed in the desert for 40 years. And so 40 years is sort of an interesting number. And we've got the number of 30, 32, 33 AD when Jesus was crucified. And we had this period up to about 70 AD, which is kind of 40-ish years, when Israel was destroyed and the nationhood of Israel was completely destroyed. The Jews were forced to leave Israel and Judea, and sort of the whole concept of Judaism was finished at that point. Now, Romans, the letter to the Romans was written before that event. And it's sort of important to bear this in mind as well. But that was, probably 70 AD, the total rejection of Israel. And I think, and I've got a feeling that there's something similar going on today as well, where God is turning back to Israel, and you know, the times of the Gentiles is fulfilled, and then God is going to turn to Israel, and we'll see later here that they will all return to Christ. They will all turn to Christ right at the end. Okay, let's go and dive into the chapter. And it says, I say then, has God cast away his people? Certainly not, for also am I an Israelite, the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not cast away his people whom he foreknew. Or do you not know what the scripture says of Elijah, how he pleads with God against Israel, saying, Lord, they've killed your prophets and torn down your altars, and I alone am left, and they seek my life. But what does the divine response say to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Even so then, at this present time, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And if by grace, then it is no longer of works, otherwise grace is no longer grace. But if it is of works, it is no longer grace, otherwise work is no longer work. Okay. What then? Israel has not obtained what it seeks, but the elect have obtained it. And the rest were blinded, just as it is written. God has given them a spirit of stupor, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear, to this very day. And David says, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a recompense to them. Let their eyes be darkened so that they do not see, and bow down their back always. Okay, so let's go through the first part of this chapter. And I mean, Paul makes a valid claim, and he says Israel's rejection is not total. That's the headline here. But he says, has God cast away his people? And he says, certainly not, because there are plenty of Jews within the Christian community. Paul is one, and to be fair, all the writers of the New Testament are Jewish, except for Luke. Everybody else is Jewish. And there are two books in the New Testament, which is the Gospel according to Luke and the Book of Acts. And they were written by a Gentile. Everything else has been written by a Jew. And so let me just turn this down. Okay. So we can see that God has not rejected his people. And also, I meant this point before, when you go through the centuries and you sort of trying to look what was going on within the Jewish community, there were always individuals who would become Christians and who would accept Jesus Christ as their savior. More so today than ever before, a lot of people from within the Jewish community are coming to Christ, and they're realizing who Jesus Christ is. So there's it's almost something like a revival going on within the Jewish community. Even in Israel today, I listened to some figures some time ago, and there was somebody talking about just data, statistical data of what they know, that when the state of Israel was founded, sort of Messianic Jews were less than a percentage point. They were just a tiny fraction, you know, just a couple of individuals, really. Yeah. But today, you are hitting about sort of several percentage points, up to 5% of the population who are Messianic Jews. And that is quite significant. That's pretty much similar to, you know, Western Europe and other countries as well. And so, the point which is to be made here is that God is reaching out to the Jewish people. And we know, according to the scripture, that when the end comes, right in the last days, Zechariah chapter 12, and it says in there that they will look upon the one they've pierced, and they will mourn bitterly, like one mourns for an only son. And they will realize who Jesus Christ is and what they have done, you know, 2,000 years ago, and that they have rejected him for so long. And yet he is the answer to all of their problems and to all about Israel and about, you know, the Word of God. He is the Word of God. Right. We can see as well that, you know, God has given them a spirit of stupor. They cannot see and they cannot hear. And yet there is a remnant as well. We see this here. Paul refers to the story of Elijah, where he was, you know, he just had this great battle with all the prophets of Baal. And there was this contest about the sacrifice and who would win. And you know, the prophets of Baal, they were dancing and chanting and trying to get their God to move on their behalf. And Elijah just, you know, had his sacrifice and he filled it up with water. He filled up the trench with water and made it really wet. And then he had a simple prayer and God accepted his sacrifice. And they knew that Baal is not God, but the God of Israel, the God of Elijah, is God. And he had the prophets of Baal killed by the crowd who was there. And Jezebel was after his life, and she tried to kill him. And Elijah got pretty much depressed and frustrated about it. He had the greatest victory probably in the history of the Old Testament, you know, as far as contests go. And yet, he fell into a deep depression, and he thought, "Oh dear, you know, I'm dead because Jezebel is after my life, and she's trying to kill me. And I'm the last one, the only one who is still loyal to God." And God corrects him, and he says, "There are 7,000 people. Is it 7,000? 7,000 men who have not bowed their knee to Baal." Yeah. So there were still people around who were faithful to God. Small remnant, but the small remnant was there. And that is pretty much today as well. We've got a small remnant within the Jewish community who follow Christ. Okay, then we have got the next part, and this is quite interesting, and it talks about the times of the Gentiles. Let's go through the text, and it says in verse 11, "I say then, they have stumbled, that they should fall? Certainly not. But through their fall, to provoke them to jealousy, salvation has come to the Gentiles. Now, if their fall is riches for the world, and their failure riches for the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you, Gentiles, inasmuch as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry. If by any means I may provoke to jealousy those who are of my flesh and save some of them. For if their being cast away is the reconciling of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? For if the first fruit is holy, and the lump is also holy, and if the root is holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches were broken off, and you, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them became partaker of the root and the fatness of the olive tree, do not boast against the branches. But if you do boast, remember that you do not support the root, but the root supports you." Okay, let me just stop here. So Paul recognizes there's a big problem. The Jewish people are not accepting the gospel, and that is in his days. And he says that the first fruit is holy, and the lump is also holy, and he talks about branches, and there's a wild olive branch which represents the Gentiles, and the natural olive branch is broken off, and the wild one is plucked in. And Paul says that we shouldn't really boast against the branches that have been ripped out, because it is not us who support the root, but it's the root who supports us. Yeah. We shouldn't be proud, or we should just be grateful. And that should maybe be the mentality when you meet a Jewish guy who is, you know, not very favorable towards Christianity. Just remember that Jesus was Jewish, and that it's that we are on the foundation of their scriptures, which we consider to be our scriptures as well, that our faith exists, yeah, and that it is on the basis of their heritage that we are in Christ. And I mean, sometimes it is done, you know, when we talk about the West, there's also the phrase of Judeo-Christian ethos and Judeo-Christian legacy and things like that, heritage. So there's the acknowledgement there. Yeah, that we have got a common root, yeah, Christianity as well as Judaism. Bearing in mind that I know a lot of Christians who have got surnames who sound very Jewish to me, and they've been Christians for generations, and probably their origins were within Judaism as well. And sometime in the denseness of history, probably somebody in the ancestry is switched over from Judaism to Christianity, from following the Tanakh and the Old Testament to following Jesus Christ and realizing who Jesus Christ is. Okay, just something to throw out there. We shouldn't be proud. We shouldn't be arrogant against them. Even though, you know, sometimes when you look at Judaism, they're pretty much, I don't know what the term is, hate Christianity. are very dubious about Christianity. They don't trust Christians, possibly because of what's happened in the past. There's been 2,000 years of Jewish persecution, which has been prophesied in the Bible, that they will become a byword, which has happened, that they will be persecuted, that they will be driven from one country to another. It's all happened. And that's all been prophesied in the Old Testament. And we can see this. So their last exile, which went to the ends of the earth, where their identity was used as a byword, as a swear word. I mean, this has all happened. It's historically there, and you can go down every time. So Jews were driven from one place to another. They settled down in a place, and it took only one or two generations, and then suddenly persecution started against them. And it's pretty much all over the place. It's a really sad history, what was going on there. But that is the history, and that was prophesied in the Bible as well. God prophesied this, if they go into the total and absolute apostasy, this is what's going to happen. They will be driven away to the ends of the world. They will be into exile, driven away from the country. Okay, but now they're coming back, and we have got in Romans 11 that there will be total salvation of the Jews, of Judaism, of the Israelites, which are there. Bearing in mind, we've got the 10 lost tribes. We don't know where they are. There are some suggestions that some of them disappeared in the Assyrian Empire, possibly in Afghanistan and elsewhere. And there will be salvation for them in the end. And they will come to Christ. They will understand who Jesus Christ is. Okay, now Paul talks about the thing, and I'm going to go from verse 25. For I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise of your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved, as it is written. The deliverer will come out of Zion, and he will turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant with them, when I take away their sins. Concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sake, but concerning the election, they are beloved for the sake of their fathers. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. For as you were once disobedient to God, yet have now obtained mercy through their disobedience, even so these also have now been disobedient, that through the mercy shown you they also may obtain mercy. For God has committed them all to disobedience, that he might have mercy on all. Okay. Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgment and his ways past finding out. For who has known the mind of the Lord, who has become his counselor, or who is first given to him, and it shall be repaid to him. For of him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. Okay, what a lovely prayer right there at the end. But it is true, we're looking at the theology, and we're looking about, the concept, the call of the Jews and the call of the Gentiles. How does it fit together? And we've got, switching from one to the other, and then right at the end, switching back. How does it all fit together? And Paul says here, all the depth, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How deep is the wisdom of God? We cannot comprehend it, and we cannot understand it. And that is something which we have to bear in mind, that the wisdom of God is deep. It's very, very deep. And he says here, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. It's difficult. Yeah? Some of this stuff doesn't make a lot of sense to us, and it doesn't have to. Otherwise, God wouldn't be God. Okay, but there are a couple of things which are here. And Paul talks about the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. Yeah. Okay, this is the way I understand it. Am I right? I don't know. I think there will be salvations going on, and they are happening all the time. There are people being revived, called, and they respond, and they become the elect, the elected of the nations. And when the last person has come in, who is supposed to come in, and I believe this is going to happen when the gospel is being preached to all nations, possibly even to the whole world. Everybody has heard the gospel to some extent. And then there will be this call, the call up, the last trumpet, because the last Gentile has come in, and then the dispensation of the Gentiles is going to be fulfilled, and then God is going to turn to the Jews. And I think what will happen, and we can see this in the book of Daniel, and we can see this in the book of Revelation, is that the nation of Israel is going to be driven really, really hard. And there's going to be great tribulation, and they're going to be pressed really, really hard. And they will cry out for God. And then eventually they will have the knowledge of their Savior when Jesus returns. And they will return to Christ. And we've got the prophecy in Zechariah chapter 12. We looked at it in our last talk, that they will look on the one they've pierced, and they will weep bitterly, like one for an only begotten son, like an only son. And there's something is going to happen to the Jewish spirit, to the nation of Israel, that they will repent, and that they will come and accept Christ for who he is. And when this happens, the whole nation of Israel will be saved. The whole nation of Israel will be saved. It's going to be interesting as well. I don't know how far this goes. Obviously, we've got Israel. Predominantly, we've got Judahites and Benjamites in there. But there are the 10 other tribes, possibly Levites as well, but there are 10 other tribes which have kind of disappeared in the Assyrian Empire. And we don't know where they are. I don't know whether there's suddenly going to be a revival amongst them. The people will just know that they belong to the nation of Israel, and they will come and come back to the land, to Eretz Israel. I don't know. When I was in Pakistan, I heard people talk about this, and some people were talking to people from Afghanistan, and a lot of Afghanis, even though they were Muslims, they knew that their heritage and their origin was Jewish or Israelitish, I don't know. But that they were Israelites, yeah, and that they were from one of the 10 tribes. And some tribes in Afghanistan, they had this understanding. Yeah. I'm not sure where the rest of them have. There's a lot of speculation going on, and I've heard, I wouldn't say a million, but probably about half a dozen theories of where these people are hiding. And some believe they're in Northern Europe, some in Russia, some in Afghanistan, some somewhere hidden away in the Middle East and in Persia and all over the place. Nobody really knows, but God. And it's going to be interesting to see. I believe if you are a Christian, you will be watching this from the other side of the veil. This will be past rapture, I believe. I may be wrong. And it's obviously it's very dangerous when you talk about eschatological ideas and concepts. But that's what they are. They're just ideas and concepts. We know that the Bible is right. We only have revelation in part. And as the time comes nearer, we will understand better. Yeah, there's no question about this. But and that's the way we need to approach this as well. So we shouldn't get dogmatic about end time doctrine, but we should look at it, discuss it, embrace it. But it should lead us into, and this is again what I'm coming to, it should lead us into an expectation of the return of the Lord. And it should change us in the way we approach our daily life. We should live like this is our last day, and that the Lord could come back tomorrow. Yeah. And I think when I look at all the signs, when I look at the conversions that is going on, when I look at everything that is happening around us, it is not that far-fetched. And it certainly is, I think today we see more than what we've ever seen before. So it's just something to bear in mind. So end time doctrine should lead us into the expectation of the return of Christ, the whole idea of Maranatha. The problem is there are a lot of cults and a lot of strange and bizarre groups which over time have been talking about the end time theory and have abused this whole doctrine and tried it to manipulate people into all sorts of stuff, and that's a problem. And so a lot of people are very careful about this. Now I'm just talking into thin air. You may be on the other side, you may be listening to this talk. I've got no interest monetarily in any other way. Yeah, my interest is that your heart opens up to Jesus Christ, and that your day tomorrow will be better than the day yesterday, as far as your relationship with God is concerned. That's my prayer, that's my interest, that's all I hope for, that's all I want to get out of this. But again, just be open, you know, consider what is happening. And when you read stuff like Romans 11, it is very, very powerful. It's very potent. When you read at Matthew 24, it says that, you hear of rumors of wars, of plagues and pestilences, and so on, so on, so on. But then Jesus said, the gospel of the kingdom has to be preached to all nations, then the end will come. Yeah? The gospel of, the kingdom of God has to be preached to all nations, then the end will come. And that is really the trigger point, has it been done? And how do we define nations? Is it people groups? Is it political entities? How do we understand this? Does it mean every person? So there are a couple of questions when we try to interpret the scripture. And Paul talks here about the time of the Gentiles when they are fulfilled. And I would say the time of the Gentiles are fulfilled when the gospel is being preached to all nations, and the last soul that is, part of the elect, when that soul comes in, then the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. We'll be out of here. And then God is going to, the whole issue is world versus Israel at this point. And God is going to turn his attention back to his people. And through a very tough time, he will get them to finally, as a whole nation, accept Jesus Christ as their Messiah. Okay, last point. How close are we that the gospel has been preached to all nations? Ages ago, I think some people say there are 190 odd nations. Some people say 200 and a bit. I once had a count a few years ago. And again, it's really the definition of what is a nation and what do you describe as a nation. I came up to about 230 nations. I'm not quite sure where the number is. It's about 200, depending on how you stretch the definition or not. Question is, has the gospel been preached to all nations? And the answer is yes. There was one island nation. And it is quite interesting. The UN said, okay, they are these islanders. They are just savages. Somebody found them somewhere in the Pacific. They had no exposure to the West. And the UN said, nobody is allowed to go there. And it's interesting as well, because at this point, the gospel has not been preached to all nations. And the prince of this world, the devil, knows about this prophecy. So as long as nobody goes and preaches to this island, he is safe. The end is not going to come. Anyway, what's happened is somebody got the call of God. He went and preached to these savages, and they killed him. And the UN was really upset about this, and how dare they do this, and so on. And it didn't really make big news. It was sort of in the some Christian news outlets where you could find about this information. Anyway, that was one nation, and they've heard the gospel. I don't know how far this missionary got, but he got killed in the process of preaching to them. And it may be, that this is one of the last nations. Maybe somebody else is still to go there because he didn't manage to get the gospel out. So what else have you got? There was another group of people who lived in trees, and I think they were somewhere in New Guinea or somewhere sort of in the Far East. And and anyway, they were being reached out as well, and missionaries were getting ready to go in to preach to them. And this is, where we are at the moment, that they are just small people groups dotted about in the world, and you might have an argument and, consider them to be a nation within their own right because they speak their own language, have their own political system. They may not, be on a world map with a country name or something, but it's happening now. It's happening right now. And I can say that we are not far off. That we are not far off of this task in Matthew 24, that the gospel is being preached to all nations, and then the times of the Gentiles is fulfilled. And to be fair, in the first generation of Christianity, people were talking about, preaching the gospel, all over the world. And people thought that Jesus was going to come back in their generation, and they almost did it. I mean, when you look at where some of the people went in the first generation of Christianity, and people went out to the Scythians, which are the Russians. They went out to, I think they went all the way up to China, Persia, the Germans as well, throughout the Roman Empire. So there was probably a justified expectation that the gospel was being preached to the known world at that time. Okay, with hindsight, we know there were still the Americas, the Australias, and other places as well, where which were unknown at the time. We don't even know whether people were living there for sure at the time, but they were unknown at the time, and there was much more to explore and much more to reach out to. But again, today we are almost there, if we haven't already done it. The answer is, you know, when this happens, the end will come, the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled, and we need to get ready. We need to get ready to meet the Lord up in the air. We need to get ready for the rapture. Okay, I'm going to stop at this point. Thank you for listening. We're going to carry on with Romans. There are a few more chapters to go through, and you know, maybe just having a little bit of an overlook as well. and we'll see how we carry on. But as I said before, Romans, very foundational letter. If you are a young Christian, it's probably important for you to try to get your head around it. Now, when you look at the way Paul writes, some of the stuff is it's a bit difficult to understand. There's a lot of Greek style of writing, way of arguing, and you can see this in this text. And sometimes you need to get past these points, but the core message in Romans is very, very important. It helps you to understand our relationship with the Old and the New Testament. Obviously, the other letters are just as important, and a lot of subjects are picked back up again. Galatians, for example, the law and the New Covenant, it's a very big subject in there. And so it's important as well. Okay, I'm going to leave it at this point. God bless and bye-bye. Here from Michael at Seismic Radio, at BPN Radio. Hope you've got a great day. And live in the expectation of the return of Jesus Christ. He will return for his people. He will return for his church. He will take us home. And if you suddenly see and hear there are loads of people missing, and they are not here and they are not there, this is an essential part, essential doctrine of the New Testament. If you find this, you will find yourself very close to the Great Tribulation, or to the Tribulation, then the Great Tribulation. Watch out in the news. Some guy is going to make a covenant with Israel, a peace treaty with Israel, and that's when the clock starts. And this can happen straight after the rapture event. It might happen a couple of years later, might happen a couple of weeks later, might happen a couple of days later, I don't know. But when this happens, the countdown starts, and you've got about 7 years, and 7 years are going to be horrible times. All I can tell you is, when you come into the situation and you find yourself on the other side of this event where loads of people disappear, you need to make sure that you are right with God, and that you put yourself on the side of God. The last thing I can say, read the book of Revelation, make sure you've got a Bible, and it'll be your newspaper to see what is going on and what will happen in these days. And if anybody ever asks you to take a mark on your right hand or your forehead, all I want to tell you is, don't take the mark. You know, you take the mark and that's your eternity gone. You may as well, you're finished at that point. So there's no question about it. You are finished. You are ready for the lake of fire. That's your entry into hell. You will not even be able to understand the gospel. If you hear this on the other side, you will not understand what I'm seeing. You will just think that I'm a raving lunatic. But that's okay, that's fine. If you haven't done it, don't take it. It is your eternity that is at stake at this point. Read the book of Revelation and read about the mark of the beast and the mark which they try to force you to take on your right hand or your forehead, and you must not take it. I'm going to leave at this point. God bless, and bye-bye from Michael here at Seismic Radio.